This week on Maker Update, a watch from the future, a clock from the past, a phone case that picks lunch, and an out-of-the-box Aimbot. Hey, I'm Donald Bell, and welcome back to another episode of Maker Update, where we collect the coolest maker projects and tips from across the internet. I hope you're doing well. We've got a great show for you. Let's get started with the project of the week. I'm not really a watch guy, but you show me a wrist full of micro dot matrix LED displays and I'm going to get excited. On his channel, Alexander Gorovenko, aka Sahko, shows how he made this stunning digital watch using 15 of these HCMS 2901 teeny tiny LED matrix modules. They kind of have the look of a vintage calculator vacuum fluorescent display, but they're fully digital and can be run at low voltage. But given that each of these displays cost about $30 each, this is a relatively expensive timepiece, and a fickle one too. To get the displays to wrap around your wrist, the design uses a custom-designed flexible PCB. The displays, however, are anything but flexible. They're not even surface mount. He's attaching these by bending and clipping the leads on each display and individually soldering each leg. A hot air station would make this a lot faster, but because the displays are encased in plastic, they begin melting before the solder does. Which is all to say, based on Sahko's opinion, I wouldn't recommend undertaking this project unless you simply have an all-consuming desire for it. A kit will not be forthcoming, and you'll probably spend more time repairing it than showing it off. Nevertheless, Sahko shares his schematics, code, and bill of materials for you to take the idea and run with it. It's a beautiful and mesmerizing proof of concept and a great showcase for these cool little displays. Also, bonus points for the DigiKey box. You can find a link to the project along with all the projects I'll mention in this video down in the description. More projects, in fact, more clocks. I think the perfect flip side to Sahko's retro-looking digital watch is this all vacuum tube, silicon-free clock by Charles Van Den on Hackaday. You heard that right. There are no transistors, microcontrollers, or chips used in this design. Even the clock input is calculated by dividing up the mains power frequency. There are four Nixie tubes at the top to read out the time. But my favorite part here are the seven tubes in the bottom section. These are called decatrons, and they're used to divide and count out the time, but they also work as a type of memory element. As I understand it, at the end of each cycle, each decatron discharges into the following one, moving from the bottom right, which takes 5 revolutions per second, up to the top left, which counts out the hours. Like the wristwatch, it's both beautiful and impractical, but also incredible and a real gift to have it all explained and documented. Of course, the best use for a clock is to let you know it's time to eat. Figuring out what to eat, though, that's another problem. On the Karakurist YouTube channel, we have a fun solution. It's an all-mechanical 3D-printed food roulette wheel that snaps onto the back of your phone. There's no additional hardware needed here, and the STL files for this are free to download. Of course, the food options are all in Japanese, so you'll probably want to modify the roulette wheel, but it's also an opportunity to change the theme. Maybe you want a chore wheel or creative prompts for when you feel stuck. It's a cool mechanism in general, whether you stick it on your phone or not. And now for the most practical project this week, at least if you're a gamer. On his YouTube channel, Kamal Carter shows how he used a combination of CNC hardware and computer vision object detection to make his own aimbot system for auto-targeting enemies in the video game Valorant. Using aimbot software hacks to get an advantage in video games is nothing new, and game developers are getting better at detecting and booting users who've hacked their games. Kamal's solution leaves the game alone and essentially gives his mouse AI superpowers to move and click and detect enemies all on its own. From the game's perspective, he's just using stock hardware. Kamal's video gives an interesting and detailed walkthrough of the challenges he faced and the solutions he came up with. If you're a gamer or if there's some other task you do that could make use of an automated mouse and computer vision system, check out this video to see what he's doing. Now for some tips and tools. On his channel, Jeremy Fielding has an in-depth guide to choosing and using linear actuators. If you're new to the idea of linear actuators, it's a fancy sounding word for a device that turns energy into linear motion, a straight line back and forth. On a small scale, a solenoid is a type of linear actuator. It uses a magnetic coil to move a pin up and down or in and out. But in Jeremy's video, we're really focusing on larger, heavy-duty linear actuators, the kind of thing that could move your standing desk up and down or open and close the security gate. Not only does he show some great examples of best practices for placing linear actuators in your design, but he also covers the major differences between the three main types: pneumatic, hydraulic, and electric. Over on the Maker's Muse channel, Angus has some great advice for how to improve accuracy and tolerances in your 3D designs and print settings. If you're designing parts that need to fit together and it's not happening, it's not always clear what the problem is. Are the measurements wrong in the model? Or is it an issue with the slicer? Or is your printer doing something to throw things off? Angus covers 8 common mistakes and how to fix them. You also get some useful design tips that can help make your future projects more resilient against temperamental filaments and imperfect printer settings. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, we've got an all new video in the Another Teaching Moment series. This time, we're taking a look at the difference between capacitive and resistive touch sensors. Specifically, we're looking at how these different sensor technologies are integrated into touchscreen applications. Both approaches have some very notable pros and cons worth considering for your next project, so take a look. You can find the link to the video down in the description. All right, and that does it for this week's show. Be sure to subscribe, leave a thumbs up, leave a comment. Big thanks to DigiKey, as always, for making this show possible, and thank you for watching. I'll see you soon.